Hello and welcome back to another edition of our scratch-built two-seat radio control Spitfire build. As ever, please like and subscribe to support our channel, and if you press the little bell icon below, you'll get updates, notifications as when there's something new out on the channel. Now, the term scratch-built often gets bandied around, particularly on the internet, to do with model aircraft, sometimes with people building, using wood and such, radio control models from a kit. Sometimes it's used as people producing aircraft from a plan that others have produced, but in this case, the true sense, we're going to produce our own plans and our own parts to produce this model. So let's have a look how we're going to produce those plans then. Firstly, we need some reference material, and this is just one of the Spitfire books I have. This is a brilliant one. I'll put a link in the description below. This one's specifically about Merlin powered Spitfires. They also do one, however, for later marks of Spitfire that are Griffon powered. And in this particular book, there's everything you could possibly need to know about Spitfires, from details of each individual mark to colour schemes, instrument panel layouts, and also detailed 3 views of each different mark of Spitfire.
If you recall, the size and construction of our model is very similar to the Balsacraft Spitfire we mentioned in part 1. This is the plan from building that project, and you should always keep the plans for reference when the project's finished. This is the plan for constructing the wings, and this one for the fuselage and tailplane. And unusually, this aircraft uses a tailplane of scale area. Often, Spitfire models are designed with increased tailplane area to make them fly better. However, the Balsacraft Spitfire flies just fine. So we'll do the same. However, our tailplane will have a built-up construction. That said, we're actually going to start by drawing the plan for the rudder, as it's much simpler. Here we are back in Mesh Mixer with the 3D drawing by Carlos Sestra. I'm isolating just the rudder part of the drawing. Now we'll rotate that down so it's parallel with the ground plane, and we'll take a projection as a .svg file to export out to Inkscape. Inkscape is a vector drawing program, and here's our rudder, although I have jumped ahead a little bit to keep the film interesting. The red lines represent a thin plywood core with rib positions taken from a 3 view from that book I showed you earlier. Meanwhile, the black lines represent 16th balsa, and 16th balsa either side should bring the thickness up to be the same as the rear of the fuselage. The grain will go up and down on this part, a little like the stern post. And what we're doing here is using the path difference, like a subtraction function, to isolate the parts that will form the outer perimeter of the rudder. I'm also cutting notches where 16th balsa stiffeners will be fitted in the scale rib positions. Now we'll just delete away all the rubbish we don't want and then rotate the parts so the grain will go in the longest direction when they're cut. Now over to the laser software, where we'll import our rudder and turn it through 90 degrees. This will ensure that the grain goes along the longest direction, as the piece of wood set in the laser has the grain going side to side like this. The colours we're setting set the order of cutting, so the black ones will be cut first and then the blue ones. And this means that as the parts fall through onto the laser bed, they'll be out of focus, so we want to cut all the holes first. We'll also set the power and speed of the cut. Here, we're motoring the laser table to the correct height so the beam is focused on the wood. And finally, checking that the design will fit on the piece of wood from our slewed start position before cutting the part.
So here's our laser cut parts then, and these notches are to take the micro size Robart pin hinges, and it will be the micro size that this requires. And now we need a flat area to put this down on. I've selected quite hard balsa because these structures are quite slender. So this is for this side. There we are, and despite the plywood centre that we cut being very flimsy and fragile, flexible, and it just being 16th by 16th of an inch balsa sticks, now that all those parts are working together, it's actually quite firm, twist resistant and robust. All that's left to do now is to sand this to profile using a sanding block. Here we go. Since last time, when we left you, we just joined the two fuselage halves inside the mould and we were waiting for them to set. And now here it is extracted out of the mould. There's a slight blue tint, which is the release agent, which we have to give it all a good wash with soap and water and alcohol to get rid of that yet. And you can also see we need to clean these edges up and fill the seams and such. There's one or two voids here and there to fill, but nothing too drastic. We also need to make some internal structure, both to stiffen the fuselage and to support things such as the radio gear and the motor and things like that. And since last time we met, we've sourced the motor that we're going to power it with. Here it is, it's an AXI 2820-14 brushless motor. And although this is one of the more expensive in the range that would power this aircraft, an Overlander 3548 would suffice, probably with a 50 amp speed controller in case we choose to run on four cells as well as three, and that will turn an 11 by 7 inch propeller on three cells. All exciting stuff.
Now onto that tailplane plan I was promising, and again we're going to take a section of the tailplane from the 3D drawing where the tailplane meets the fuselage. Once again, using this tailplane section imported into Inkscape meant I could draw these plans. I've opted for 3/32 medium balsa ribs and spars with sheeting from softer 16th thick balsa. Unlike the slab tail on the Balsacraft Spitfire, this will be stiffer yet lighter. And here you can see that I've scaled the tailplane section to match the rib lengths on the plan. I've also drawn these little jig tabs for alignment as we build it.
So here I've printed the plan out. And because it's bigger than A4, I've had to use two bits of paper and stick it together with sellotape. And then I've protected that with some cling film, all taped down to this flat board. The board is a chunk of worktop, which I've nailed a piece of cheap flooring ply to, so we can knock some pins into it. And these are our tailplane parts. We're going to start by laminating this tailplane spar. Nice and flat like this, and then these notches are for the ribs. So we need to start by laying this up nice and flat on the plan. leading edges applied and chamfered ready, and the corner T7 pieces are sanded down flush. Now we're going to apply the 1/16th of an inch Balsa top sheeting. We're going to use some aliphatic, but we're also going to use little dibs of CA glue just to hold the sheeting down to the curve while the aliphatic sets. Now that all that's cured and I've trimmed around the edges and I've also marked the centre line, we can now turn this over and we no longer need these little jig tabs or indeed this surface that was keeping it all flat while it was held down to the board while it cured. So now what we're going to do is just remove these tabs. Then we can mark these corners to be cut off like this. And now that the other side is sheeted and all the edges tidied up, I've now applied the actual leading edge, which gets both the top and bottom sheeting. Just tidy that up and round it off, and then we're finished. So with the leading edge added, trimmed and rounded to a nice flowing profile, that's the tailplane finished. And of course, with the rudder that we completed earlier, that's two finished items from drawing, design, cutting and construction. And of course, all that's left to do now is a couple of coats of sand and sealer, the hinges and of course the covering. And that concludes this edition. Thanks for watching. Join us next time where we'll continue our progress with this radio controlled two-seat Spitfire build.